We're now joined by Pastor Wole Olushola to lead us into the significance or importance of Christmas celebration in Christendom. Wole Olushola is the lead pastor of Grace Life Church in Lagos. Good to have you on Newsday, Pastor.
Good afternoon and great to be here. Merry Christmas to everyone.
Yes, I was going to say Merry Christmas to you. As Nigerians as Nigerians celebrate the Yuletide season, the usual rise in travel activity has taken on a slower pace this year. So what's your view on how Nigerians are celebrating, particularly those who can't travel out and those who are stuck in Lagos? How do you feel they should go about celebrating?
Whatever happens, we have no choice but to be grateful for Christmas, you know, because Christmas is beyond what we can see, what we can touch, or what we can hear. It's about the love of God for the human race. For example, when you hear the names Ronaldo and Messi, what comes to your mind is football. They were born to play football. So when you hear the name Jesus, what comes to your mind is about the Savior that was born to die for our sins. So Christmas is all about the love of God. No matter what we are going through, it doesn't change the fact that God loves us. And God's love is immeasurable. It has no depth. So when we think about the love of God alone, it's enough to be grateful about for. So no matter what we are going through, we should always be confident that nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And that's what Christmas is all about. It's about the love of God for us.
So, yeah, the essence of Christmas is what you have pointed out there. How really should people celebrate Christmas? Because when Christmas comes, people think about traveling, people think about parties, people think about such other things. But how should people really, especially those of the faith, celebrate Christmas? What should it mean to them?
Salvation, eternal life, security, peace of mind. Because when we travel, no matter where we travel to, we are going to eventually come back. We are going to finish eating all the food. But the only consistent thing is God's presence that remains with us. So when we think about those things that Christmas brings to us that money cannot buy, we have no choice but to remain eternally grateful to God, especially when you consider that we don't deserve any of these things, but they've been freely given to us because of the love that God has for us. So when we think about that alone, irrespective of what we have or don't have, we'll remain grateful to God for all he has done for us.
Okay, Pastor Wole, I want to ask if you could share your own personal journey this year in the midst of the COVID pandemic, how it has affected you as a person, as a Christian, especially when you couldn't gather the way you were used to gathering, and how out of that, maybe you can encourage those who feel a little isolated and some even depressed because of the way their social expression of their faith has been forced to change. Like some are already mourning the fact that they can't do crossover, you know, for New Year, and it means so much to them. So how has your personal journey impacted your ability to encourage and comfort those who are feeling a little disconnected at this time?
Well, whenever anything happens to us in life, the first question we need to ask ourselves is this: what is God trying to communicate to me through this? Because in everything we go through, God always brings out a lesson. I'll be sincere with you. COVID-19 and the lockdown was like a rude shock and a rude awakening. Nobody expected it. However, you know, it's all about making the best of every situation. So the Bible says that in all things, give thanks, for this is the will of God for those in Christ Jesus. We are not giving thanks for what is happening, but we are giving thanks because we know that in the midst of what is happening, God will always make a way of escape. He always makes all things to work together for our good. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10:13 that there's no temptation that has come our way that is not common to man. But God is faithful. He will not allow us to be tested beyond what we can bear. And within the same temptation, he will always make a way of escape. So the key thing is this: whatever happens, we are in good hands with God, and he always works all things out together for our good. So that's how I have stayed encouraged. That's how my family has stayed encouraged. And that's how our church members have stayed encouraged. We don't look at what is happening, but we look at what God can make happen and bring out through what is happening.
Today, Christians all over the world celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. What should be the lessons that people can take from his life, not just for people of faith, but for leaders generally, leaders, be it church leaders, be it secular leaders like government leaders. That's one. And then secondly, the governor has said no cross overnight. I mean, it's I don't know whether to use the word traditional. Yes, traditional for Christians to do cross overnight. What do you make of that instruction from the governor? And do you think that pastors across should really obey it?
First and foremost, one thing we can learn from the life of Jesus is that he was a servant leader. He puts the people he came to serve first before himself. You know, in as much as he went as far as washing the feet of his servants to show us how we ought to lead people. So leadership is not by position. It's about the impact that we can make. Now, as per the crossover, it's very important to know that the Bible says in Romans 13 that we are to obey every government. So whatever directive or instruction the governor has made, we as Christians have to obey the laws of the land. We are not immune to the laws of the land. We are not above the laws of the land. Then, however, you see, the crossover service is not about a physical building. As long as we can meet online, we are still meeting. That's the most important thing. They've not said we shouldn't do service. All they said was that there should be no physical gathering. So whether online or not, the most important thing is that we can still meet. And that's, you know, and that's what I take from it. So there are going to be services online, and nobody's going to stop us from praying. Nobody's going to stop us from preaching. So the church is beyond the physical building. And that's what I want people to take from that. The church is not a physical building. The church is a gathering of believers, whether online or wherever we gather. So it doesn't really make any difference to me, because we'll still gather online and we'll still be able to celebrate God and cross over into the new year.
The church is the pressing.
Yes.
Yeah, the church is the pressing.
Yes.
And then, of course, the gathering continues.
Yes, I was just going to ask, when you said all things work together for good, do you see any silver lining in some of the way COVID-19 has forced us to review our emphasis on the way we do church? You know, so some might say maybe a less, exorbitant way of doing Christmas may force people to be more introspective. I'm just leading you on in that. So do you see any working together for good in the way COVID-19 has reshaped the way we do church? Maybe perhaps something we can carry over even beyond COVID-19?
Of course. COVID-19 has brought a lot of positives. So, for example, there's a limit to the number of people we can gather in a physical building. But when you are online, what you do online is a church without walls. You can reach as many people as possible. And you can also invade the spaces of people online without taking permission from them, because you are online. So what COVID-19 has done is that for our own church, and for many churches I know, it has brought us to a stage where we have been forced to pay more attention to being online, to spread the word of God online, and which we were not taking seriously before. So COVID-19 has worked together for our good. The lockdown, it has made us to see the potentials in doing digital church online. When you look at Zechariah chapter 2, verses 3 and 5.
All right. Just hold on. We'll keep you up, boss. I'm going to get right back to you and continue the discussion. But now, let's cross to our rights correspondent, Chaito Atigari, who has been around worship centers across Lagos to know, feel, how Christians are celebrating in those particular centers where she is. Chaito.
Just kick off now. I'm here at the Diocese of Lagos, here at Marina, and I just want to ask a few questions. Merry Christmas, sir. How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling good. I'm feeling great. I'm thankful to God, because we can't thank God enough for sparing our lives to see this day. Indeed, we are very, very grateful to God. We express our infinite gratitude and appreciation to Him. forever and ever. We continue to serve and we continue to appreciate him for the benefits of salvation and the blessings of life.
We can't ignore the fact that this year has been a very tumultuous one, especially with the pandemic. And there are lots of Christians that are feeling a bit low at this time of the year, because normally we'll be out, you know, celebrating, but now we have a lot of people staying back at home because they are scared of this particular virus. How would you react to that, sir?
Yes, in the midst of the troubled world, we should have faith in God. And Christ came to give us that peace. He is the Prince of Peace. Even in the midst of the troubled world, broken world, we should have that absolute peace with God. Inward peace, outward peace, and also upward peace. And when we are in peace with God, definitely everything will be okay. And then we will be able to do things rightly. And the society, we know it for better. When we are at peace with our neighbor, even at peace with the people around us, and at peace with our God.
One last question before you go, sir. If there are a lot of people that were not able to make it to the service today, if you could send them a goodwill message on this Christmas Day, uplifting their spirits with one more week to before we see 2021, what would that message be, sir?
The message is that we should just continue to keep hope alive. At the end of the tunnel, there will be light. Our God is on the throne. Our God is still reigning and is still in the business of recreation. He loves us so much. He will never allow us to be jettisoned. He will not allow us to be sorrowful, because he has promised us this everlasting joy and this eternal peace, this inward peace. Just let us be at peace with God and let us continue to move on. Tomorrow will definitely be better. And we believe that the coming years, we will have every reason to glorify and to celebrate in Jesus' name. Thank you
very much, sir. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year in advance. Thank you for talking to us. All right, then. So sorry. Well, there you have it. Very quick interview there. Indy, Kenny, I'm sure you can hear me. Still have interviews going on. But what he said, that he's just preaching the message of peace and wanting Christians all over the world to continue to hold on to hope, even as they celebrate Christmas today in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Over to you, Kenny.
What's the gathering there like? Did you manage to see how many people gathered together for the Christmas celebration?
Yes, I mean, there were quite a number of people. It's a big church here at Marina. I'm just going to have the cameraman pan around for you to see the number of people that are still left waiting to see the diocese. It wasn't a large number of people. There were a COVID-19 protocol set in place, so the church couldn't be filled to its maximum. But then there was quite a turnout, I must say. And here we're just having people who have waited behind to speak with the diocese.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you, Shaito. Are they maintaining the COVID-19 protocols, wearing of masks and sanitizers or washing of hands? What is it like?
Well, in the actual church, you're not allowed to go into the church without wearing your face mask and sanitizing your hands. But even now, as you can see, some of the people that are conducting the interviews, apart from me, of course, from Arise News, are wearing their face masks, but still doing that. This really bad behavior that we're continuing to see, where people put their face masks on their chin. So there's a mixture of that. People who are doing it the right way and people who are trying to wear their masks, but not going all the way with it and just ending up putting it on their chins. But definitely in the church, there were COVID-19 protocols duly observed.
Bad behavior. That's interesting from you, Shaita Atigari, the way she put it there. All right, and we can bring you live pictures from the Vatican, where Pope Francis is giving his Urbi et Orbi blessing inside the Apostolic Palace.
Per favore, continuate anche a pregare per me. Buon pranzo a natalizio e arrivederci.
It would seem indeed that the world over, people are still against the odds trying to continue with the things they hold dear. You could say the traditional activities of Christmas festivities. Even though, yes, you can see that there are not too many there, but there's still a significant number present where the Pope is giving his Christmas blessing. I think there's a feeling in which people want to have some regularity and some sameness so that they don't... And this Christmas is an opportunity to get that feeling that even though things have changed, some things have remained the same. And that's the impression you're getting with some of these traditional events taking
place. Rituals, I would call them, of Christmas. All right, Pastor Lushola, Wale Lushola, I hope I'm correct, is still there. Well, you were talking about church without walls, and that got me thinking the power of technology and how the church can really maximize this power going forward. That's one. And then still on the lessons learned, God, the scripture says, gave his only begotten son to impact the world. You know, let's talk about giving. You have orphanages, you have motherless babies' homes, you have widows, you have the needy. I know there are some churches who go about building schools. How do we translate what God did in terms of giving to humanity? Giving is not just money. Laughter, love, hope, counsel. Take those two in your stride, Pastor.
So as a matter of fact, a church that doesn't give is not preaching the full gospel. Because the one of the main essences of the gospel is to give to people and make a difference to human beings. The Bible talks about how Jesus went about with the Holy Ghost and with power. He went about doing good. So doing good is synonymous with the church. Now, it's not everything that people go through that you pray for. You can't pray for a hungry man. What a hungry man needs is food. You can't pray for a homeless man. What a homeless man needs is for you to give him shelter. So the church must do good works. It is part and parcel of why we are in existence. And, you know, that's one of the easiest ways we can make a difference in society. And, you know, James also talked about, he said, if somebody comes to meet you that is hungry, you don't pray for the person and say, be thou warmed or be thou filled. He said, give the person food. And that way you have solved a big problem. So for our own church, we do giveaways, we do give back to the society because that's part and parcel of what we are here for. And I know that a lot of churches also do the same things. So giving is part and parcel of the existence of the church.
Okay, well, thank you, Pastor Wale. I had another question for you, but it looks like we're out of time. All we can say now is Merry Christmas. Enjoy your Christmas celebrations. And love to your congregation.